Morning, Grace Point. Go ahead and stand with us. Let's worship the Lord this morning.
House of the Lord today. It is a beautiful, beautiful day. Beautiful day. Especially if you're a Georgia Bulldog fan. Come on. There's got to be some Bulldog fans in the house. Come on. There you go. My kids want, yeah, Purdue too. Yeah, come on. My kids want to eat today, so they're going to cheer for the Bulldogs and the Atlanta Braves. All righty, it is great to be in the house of the Lord, and it really is a beautiful day today. We're going to go to the Lord in Scripture, Psalm chapter 34, beginning in verse number 1. I will bless the Lord at all times. You know, it is easy to bless the Lord when your team is winning. You know, I mean, really, come on. Is it? But when you got more month than you got money, when the doctor calls and it's nothing but bad news, when you're worried about your kids, when you're worried about everything else, you go to the grocery store and there's no bread on the shelf, or go to Sam's and there's no toilet paper on the aisle, this scripture says, I got to bless the Lord at all times. His praise will continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. And I love this verse 4. This is my favorite verse in this psalm. I sought the Lord, and what happened? He heard me. But it's one thing to hear. He heard me, but then he said, and delivered me from all of my fears. What are you afraid of this morning? That's later. That comes in my sermon. I'm getting a little excited there. What are you afraid of this morning? Whatever it is, I promise you, the scripture promises you, the psalmist David says to you this, bring it to the Lord. Cry out to the Lord. He will hear you and he will deliver you. Can we say amen to the reading of the word today? Amen. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer. And so many of our family need prayer. We want to remember Bud and Cindy, and they're getting some medical appointments and some things that's going on with them. We want to remember them in prayer. Much like you, I'm just hearing this morning about the 17 missionaries in Haiti that were kidnapped. I've never been to Haiti. I've done some work with folks that have gone there. Andre and I trained a missionary couple while we were at the children's home that went and worked at the orphanage that the Church of God has there in Haiti. It's a rough place. It's a violent place. It's a scary place. And so we want to remember those missionaries and their families. I'm sure this morning that they have fears. But I know that my God can respond to that. If you have a request, just lift your hand this morning. The Lord sees those, every single request here today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you. We honor you, we glorify you, we praise your holy name. Lord, you're our everything, Lord. You're our hope. You're our protector. You are our giver. You are our heart. You are our savior. And Lord, you are our soon coming king. Lord, I pray that each person here today, Lord, and those that aren't here, Lord, but that are praying with us, Lord, I pray that you will touch them, that you will minister to them, that you will heal them, that you will respond to their need. Lord, with these missionaries in Haiti, Lord, we pray that you will reach out and just reassure them, Lord, with your presence. I'm sure that even in this moment that they are praying, and Lord, I pray that you will bless this service and pour your spirit out upon us. In your holy, holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. Got a lot going on in the next few days and weeks. I want to make sure everyone got your bulletin, and there's a lot of announcements in there, so please take time to read through that. Not while I'm preaching, but at some point, you know, I used to take the bulletin when my dad was preaching and fold it into an airplane. And that was okay until that one Sunday that I launched it. And I found that that was not a good use of my time during Sunday service. Couldn't sit back down the next Sunday. So remember, look at those announcements there in the bulletin. I want to hit a couple of them, not this coming Sunday, but the next Sunday, the last Sunday of the month. I believe it's the 31st, is our last debt reduction Sunday of the year. We've done really a great job this year of paying down our debt. We owe about $120,000 left on the mortgage, and we have paid a great deal of money, I think over $20,000 this year on that debt. So we want to just keep whittling that down. So everything that comes in on that last Sunday, all of the offering and anything that isn't marked tithe or some other designated fund will go straight to debt, so that that next week Rhonda will send not only our payment, but then whatever extra comes in, and we're just going to keep whittling that down. Next Sunday, immediately after church, we are going to have a brief, and I promise you it will be brief. I asked my dad one time what brief meant from a Church of God pastor standpoint, and he meant less than an hour. I mean, it's going to be a whole lot briefer than that. We've got one agenda item we're going to talk about, and we will come together and just talk about that one item and go from there. Church meeting next Sunday immediately following service. And then don't forget, in the bulletin we've got an announcement about our upcoming kid event on the 31st, I believe. Angie's shaking her head yes. Read all the details there in the fold out, and then don't forget our Christmas shoebox event that's going on as well. Well, our ushers come forward at this time. Praise the Lord. If you will take your tithe and your offering into your hand, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you and we praise your holy name. Lord, you are worthy of all of our worship, worthy of all of our glory, worthy of all the adoration. I thank you that you've given to me this week. I thank you, Lord, for blessing my family and blessing me. And Lord, I pray that you will receive this tithe and this offering today. In your holy name we pray. Amen. 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 Thank you.
you, Miss Shirley. Go ahead and stand with us, and we'll worship the Lord some more this morning.
That the highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Through the sun sets free. Oh, he's free. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me.
Remember your children, remember your
Is enough. Yeah, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. You may be seated. Kids are heading out to children's church. Oh, praise the Lord. I love reading the Bible. I do. I enjoy reading. Just not for a particular, I'm trying to work on this sermon, or I've got this devotional that I'm doing, or I just enjoy reading. If you come to the parsonage there, my chair downstairs in our basement area, got like 20 books stacked up there on the end table there beside the chair. And Andre will say, which of these can we go put on a shelf somewhere? And I'm like, well, no, not that one. I'm halfway through with it. Well, no, not that one. I've only read the first chapter. No, not that one. I'm still here. I'm still there. I'm skipping around in this one. And it's gotten so bad that Rosie has appointed herself the family librarian, and she'll come down and she'll say, Dad, the librarian's in, you need to turn some of those books in. But I love to read, and I love reading the Bible, especially just to read it, and it is full of, just even from just a literary standpoint, it's full of interesting people and intriguing stories. And if you're like me at all, you can kind of get lost in the story and put yourself in that moment, in that place, and ask yourself, well, how would I have reacted to this? Or if that was me, how would I have wanted someone to react to me? Now, one of the things that I'm absolutely convinced of, though, as you read the Bible, that each of those stories, each of those characters, they tell us something about Christ and about God and about his love for us. I heard an old preacher say that the Old Testament, every chapter in the Old Testament points to Christ, and every chapter in the New Testament reveals Christ to us. And I believe that. I believe that. I believe that these stories show us that no matter our circumstances, no matter what we might be in this moment, God is still in control, and he has a purpose for us, and he has a future for us through him to do something great and glorious for him. So this morning, we're going to spend some time with one of my favorite minor characters in the Bible. We're going to look at this story. It's found in the Gospel of Mark, and it's a story about a guy, and he's living on the side of the road, and he's been pushed aside by people. He's been ignored. He's the dregs of society. But there's something really interesting about this guy, and Mark goes so far as to even tell us his name and who his dad is, and gives us some details about this man that he typically doesn't give in the stories. Mark doesn't usually give us a lot of names. I think there's only like two or three stories in the entire gospel where he actually gives the name of the character that he's actually talking about. But this guy, man, he's been pushed aside. He's been ignored. He's been passed over. He's not had the life that he wanted to live, not had the life, I think, that his parents wanted him to have. And I wonder this morning how many of us may feel the same way. You're sitting here today and you'd say, you know what, Pastor? I look at my life and I look back on my life and there's been opportunities that I just missed. I was late. I was at the wrong place at the wrong time, or I missed it. I just didn't seize that opportunity when it came. Or you'll look at relationships, friendships, and it's like, you know, those folks have gone on and they've achieved so much, but I look at my life and it feels like everybody has moved on, but I'm still right here, right now, doing the same thing. Maybe you'd say, Pastor, I feel like I'm damaged goods. I feel like I'm on that scratch and dent aisle at the grocery store, you know, where they used to sell canned goods. Maybe that had lost the label. You didn't know if you were getting peaches or tomatoes or potatoes. But for 25 cents, that can could go home with you. Maybe you feel overwhelmed, underappreciated, ill-equipped. I don't know, maybe you'd say, Pastor, right this moment, I feel like my life is stuck. Anybody ever felt stuck? Well, today, I hope that through this story, through this little character here in Mark's gospel, that we're going to discover a couple of things. The first thing is this: you are exactly where you need to be to do something amazing for God. And God is doing something in you right now so that he can do something through you later. If you're staying with me, we're going to read about seven verses of scripture this morning out of Mark's gospel of Mark chapter 10, beginning in verse 46. I'm sure you know this story really, really well. Now, as they came to Jericho, as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great multitude, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the road begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Then many warned him to be quiet, but he cried out all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. So Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. Then they called the blind man, saying to him, Be of good cheer, rise, he is calling you. And throwing aside his garment, he rose and came to Jesus. So Jesus answered and said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said to him, "Rabboni, that I may receive my sight." Then Jesus said to him, "Go your way, your faith has made you well." And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus on the road. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the reading of your word. We thank you for your presence here today, Lord. And I ask that you anoint these next few moments that we have, Lord, and allow me to convey your message this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. One of the things that I really like about this story, and this is one of my favorite stories in the Gospel of Mark. And it's funny, I enjoy this story, but I don't like this experience in my own life. But this story is about interruption. It's about this natural progression of things that suddenly gets halted. Isn't it great, though, when God divinely interrupts a situation that we're in the middle of, divinely interrupts the moment? So we find Jesus and his disciples, and they're traveling from Jericho to Jerusalem for the Passover meal. That's kind of the setting here. And this would be the last Passover. This would be that last supper, the final supper that Jesus would have with his disciples before the crucifixion, before Judas would betray him, before he was arrested and falsely accused and beaten and crucified. This is that moment that he's walking toward Jerusalem. Many scholars have referred to this encounter with blind Bartimaeus as Christ's last recorded miracle of mercy. It's a big moment for Jesus and his disciples. And the Bible tells us that they were traveling, and there was this huge multitude going with them. And I'm sure within that multitude that there were many, many, many people that were followers of Christ, that were those that believed that he was the Son of God. And I'm sure that there were some in the crowd that weren't so sure. And then I'm sure that there were some in the crowd that were just shocked that there was a crowd. But they're traveling on to Jerusalem. Now, I did a little research, and Jericho is, by straight walk, a little less than 40 miles from Jerusalem. And they estimate that on a normal day with normal traffic, you could probably walk that in somewhere around 8 hours. But with the amount of traffic and the amount of people that were on the road that day, the amount of things that were happening, they say it was probably a 10 to maybe a 12-hour trip for Jesus and his disciples. So they're out walking. Now, in that 40, this is one of those things I wish, and you've heard me say this before, I bet there was a lot of great conversation along that road, right? I think back to family trips and the conversations that my dad and mom would have with us while we were traveling. I don't know if you ever had any of these kind of conversations, but don't make me come back there. Anybody ever had that conversation with your parents in the trip? Or maybe you use that one. You wait till we pull over. Well, yeah, those are great conversations. But no, we would talk about things. We would talk about... We would take those long trips. We'd hop in the car in South Georgia, and we'd drive all the way into the heart of Michigan. And during that trip, I would ask questions to mom, you know, what was it like to grow up in Michigan? You know, what was it like to see snow? We didn't see a whole lot of snow in South Georgia. what was it like to have to pull for the Wolverines? Yeah, or Michigan State, the Spartans. Oh, it's terrible. But we would have these great conversations. But anyway, so they're walking and they're talking, and Mark tells us that Bartimaeus was blind and he was begging on the side of the road. That's a rough life in any kind of situation, but in Ancient of Days it was even rougher, I am sure. Here is this blind man sitting on his coat, his garment, and he's begging. So as I read this story, though, I wonder how many people that day, especially that day, in that moment, passed him by and ignored him. They were on a journey to the holy city, on their way to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover. To celebrate the freedom that they experienced because of God, and yet they did not have time to minister to or deal with one of their brothers that was hurting alongside the road. How many times have we done that? We've been in such a hurry to get to where we're going that we miss an opportunity to minister to someone that God has literally put in our path. And we just missed it. I'm too busy. I'm too focused. I got too many other things to do today to minister to someone that God has literally put on the side of the road right in front of us. We don't stop for hitchhikers much anymore. Maybe not at all anymore. I remember when I turned 16 and I'm getting my driver's license, and I get this great speech from my mom and dad about responsibility and they had given me this really great hot rod car, this Plymouth Horizon, 0 to 60 in about a day and a half. Now, don't you be speeding and all of that. Well, no, Mom, I'm not going to do that. Yeah. Don't you put people in your car. Don't you be driving folks that we don't know about. And don't you pick up any hitchhikers. Anybody ever get that speech? Maybe it's because we watched too many movies as growing up. Man, if you ever picked up a hitchhiker in a movie, it was bad. It was ugly. You knew things were going to go from bad to worse. And I got to thinking, have I ever picked up a hitchhiker? I don't remember ever picking up one. I do remember, though, one time Andre and I, we were living down in Cleveland, Tennessee, and we had been up into Kentucky and visited her family. We were on our way home, and we had gotten to this beautiful place just on the other side of Jellicoe Mountain called Stinking Creek, Tennessee. That's a real place, Stinking Creek. Yeah, they had run out of names by the time they got to that one, I think, Stinking Creek. And we pass this older lady. Now, we're in our 20s, so by older, she was probably like 35. No, she was older than that. But she was broken down on the side of the road, and she looked distressed. And we stopped. And her car was boiling over, and she looked like she was just in bad shape. So we picked her up and actually took her to the next town and got off there at a gas station and got her hooked up with a mechanic that would go back and help her take care of her car. But that's the only time I remember us really ever stopping for a hitchhiker. We just don't do that anymore, for good reason, I'm sure. So Mark says that there's blind Bartimaeus, and he's on the side of the road, and he's begging. And he gives us his name. I told you that was an unusual thing for Mark. And so Bartimaeus is made up of two parts. Bar, B-A-R, in Aramaic means son of. So, son of Timaeus. Well, what does Timaeus mean? And Timaeus is made up of the word Timaeo, which means honor. So Bartimaeus' name literally means son of honor. So that's his name. That's a great name to carry, son of honor. But yet you look at his situation and his circumstance stands in great contrast to that name. He is a beggar with the title son of honor. Church, I believe that all of us today carry a title of honor. We are children of the King, sons and daughters of the Most High. We have been redeemed. We have been purchased at a price. We are freed. We have been taken out of bondage. But yet we live and choose sometimes to live in circumstances way below what our name would allow us. He's a beggar versus the name son of honor. So as a blind beggar, he's living in the margins of society and he's begging for people to help, to give him something as they travel. Now, throughout my life, I have not known many blind people. I just haven't. The only real person that I've had a lot of experience with, spent a lot of time with, was actually Andrea's grandmother, her dad's mom, Joanne. Joanne was not blind from birth. There were several situations that happened, and someday maybe Andrea can give you her testimony, but by the time she was a teenager, her sight was permanently gone, and she moved to Louisville to go to the Kentucky School of Blind, and there she met a guy who was also there at the Kentucky School for the Blind, a guy named Robert, and they got together, and they got married, and they raised three sighted children, which was amazing. Andrea's grandfather, Robert, was a blind piano tuner. He tuned pianos and owned a music shop and could play. I didn't get a chance to know him. He had passed away before I came into the family. But from everything that they've said, he was just a wonderful, great man. But I did get to know her grandmother, Joanne. And Joanne was a tiny little lady, and she had guide dogs, and it always seemed to me that the dogs were bigger than she was, but she had these dogs, and they would lead her, and one of the things I find most fascinating about her was her job. Joanne was a court stenographer. So she was the lady in the front of the court that would type up the transcripts of everything that was said. Now, I had always heard that justice was blind. It really is. Joanne was blind. And the judge that she worked for most often there in Louisville was Judge McConnell. And probably never have heard of Judge McConnell in that capacity, but you've heard of him today, I'm sure. He is the senator from Kentucky. He's the Senate minority leader, Mitch McConnell. And so when Joanne passed away, Senator McConnell actually sent us a letter, and we read it at the funeral and all. And she lived a life that was amazing. She was just an amazing lady. I remember going into her little apartment there, and the first time I was ever there, and I walked into the restroom, and I turned on the light switch because, you know, I can see. And next thing I know, this TV starts blaring in the bathroom. And I'm like, I didn't mean to turn the TV on. I was trying to turn on a light. But she had rigged up things like that in every room so that she would know if she had left the lights on. There'd be a noise so she could hear what was going on. And we would sit there in her living room and we would watch movies. She loved Star Trek shows and movies. She loved Star Trek The Next Generation. And they would start watching an episode and they would pause every couple minutes to describe what was going on so she could hear it. She could hear the dialogue and then they would describe the scene. And it was just really an interesting situation. So she couldn't see what was going on, but she interpreted the world through her ears. And that's exactly what's happening here with Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus is sitting there and he's begging, and he heard that Jesus of Nazareth was coming. He couldn't see what was happening. He couldn't look at and understand that the crowd had changed or was getting bigger or whatever, but he heard something different. He heard that Jesus was on his way. Now, Scripture doesn't tell us anything about friends or family or anybody there to help him. It doesn't tell us that anybody was there caretaking him. What it says is he heard that Christ was coming. Now, what does that mean for you and me today? It means this. It means that we got to use what God has given us to interact with him, to be of service to him, to focus on him. Instead of focusing on what we lack, let's focus on what we have. Bartimaeus heard that Jesus was coming, and he begins to shout, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." So what did he use? He used his ears to hear, and he used his mouth to shout. The Apostle Paul writes in Romans chapter 12, "Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, let us prophesy in proportion to our faith or ministry. Let us use it in our ministering. He who teaches in teaching, he who exhorts in exhortation, he who gives with liberality, he who leads with diligence, he who shows mercy with cheerfulness." Paul is telling us in this, and I think Bartimaeus is showing us in this, that we all have gifts. We all have something to give. Even a blind beggar has the ability to be used of God in that moment. What I wrote here is, and this is not grammatically correct at all, is you have dues. D-O-S. You have dues. I do have this. I do have this. God has called me and equipped me with this. I do have. So often, though, our conversation revolves around, I don't. I don't have the ability to do that. I don't have the time to do that. I don't have the talent to do that. I don't, therefore, I won't. one of the things that I think that is so beautiful about the church and really sets the church apart, sets the body of Christ apart, is that it is our beauty within the different gifts, the different talents, the different resources that God utilizes and works together to bring about his message. It takes all of us working together, all of us in unity, working for God, working for the kingdom to bring about what he wants to see and to glorify him. So this morning I say to you, what do you have right now, right where you are? What gift do you bring? I think of the great Christmas song, The Little Drummer Boy. Me and my drum, that's all I've got. What do you have? I think it's part of our nature, part of our struggle in life. We get so caught up in our mistakes. And we say, man, the mistakes that I have made, they disqualify me for service. They make it impossible for me. So I get caught up. I think about my mistakes, my imperfection. I think about my faults. And we fail to recognize the truth, and this is the truth. Each of us, each of you are a work of art perfected and made by a master sculptor. Every person that calls Christ their king is being perfected every single day. None of us have got there. None of us are perfectly perfect. None of us have it all together every minute of the day. We get so focused on our past, so focused on what has happened, that when we look at ourselves, what we see is something fractured and broken and cracked, and we tie our worth and our value to that imperfect image that we see of ourselves. And we miss out and we don't see all of the things that God has done in our life. We don't see all of the ways that he's working through our life and all of the things that he's working out for our good, for those that faithfully serve him. We kind of shade over that and only see what we lack. I want to encourage you this week, when you have one of those moments where the enemy starts saying, you're not, you don't, you can't, look at who you are and look at what God has done in your life. Look at the places that he has brought you from and where he's brought you to. And remember that he is intimately involved in your story. You're not alone. He's directing your steps. He is calling you into a deeper relationship with him. And think about this. You are absolutely beautiful in the sight of God. Where you see cracks and flaws and imperfections and wrinkles and whatever else, when God looks at you, he sees the righteousness of his son, Jesus Christ. So what does that mean for me right now, Pastor? It means that you are a masterpiece created in Jesus Christ and called to do great things. Great things. And that not only have you called for that, but God has prepared these things for you to do in advance. what do you mean? It means when God called you and equipped you to be his hands and his feet in this generation, in this world right now, he knew everything you were ever going to do in your life. He knew every mistake you were going to make, and he called you anyway. He knew every time you were going to get it wrong, and he called you anyway. He knew every time that you were going to stumble and fall, from the times you scraped your knees to the times you bloodied your nose, God saw it all first, and he called you anyway. That's a great place to say amen. Don't focus on what you don't have at the expense of forgetting what you do have. I think the story gets really interesting around verse 48. And we read that the people that were around Bartimaeus in the crowd there started telling him to shut up. Shut up. Close your mouth. We got other things going on here. Quit. And he responded, God, help us have this boldness in us. He responded by shouting even louder, Son of David, Son of David, have mercy on me. Church, we live in a culture that is doing everything they can to silence Christians, silence church people. I read a story just this week about a pastor in Canada, and you might have read the same story, that he was arrested for having church, for violating Canadian law right now, which says that unauthorized gatherings are illegal, and church is considered an unauthorized gathering right now in Canada. Just a couple years ago, before the pandemic, they tried to enforce a statute in Houston, right here in the United States, in Texas, where, you know, not only when you're born are you given a birth certificate, but you're given a gun. I mean, that's Texas, right? But in Houston, Texas, pastors had to submit their sermons in writing 2 weeks before they were preached to make sure there was nothing in there that went against the beliefs of the mayor. We live in a time when children are forbidden from praying. We read all the time where a football coach will lead his players in prayer before a game and then get fired for praying. Bartimaeus shows us that we can't be silenced. We can't be silenced. Where you are, what you're in the middle of, where you're working, whatever you're doing, if you're a student, if you're a teacher, whatever you are, don't be silenced. Declare what God has done. So here Jesus, he's traveling to Jerusalem from Jericho, and Bartimaeus, he seizes this opportunity. There are opportunities in front of you right now, opportunities to engage with Christ. Don't let these opportunities pass you by. Seize the moment that God has set in front of you. Seize that opportunity and say, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Then we get into verse 49 and 50. Jesus responded to that shouting. So Jesus stood and he commanded him to be called. Then they called the blind man, saying to him, be of good cheer, rise, he is calling you. And throwing aside his garment, he rose and came to Jesus. Man, I'd love to camp out here for a little while. I think it is just so awesome, and I really don't have time to delve into this today, but I think it is so awesome, so cool, so wonderful, that many times the very ones that are trying to shut us up are the ones that God uses to deliver the message to us, come on in. Come on up. I was trying to silence you, but now God is saying, come here. And he uses that person that was trying to steal your joy or steal your victory. And he uses them to remind you that God is still in control today. He says, come into my presence. Come up here. The very people that were rebuking him and telling him to shut up, now they stopped. And they had to escort Bartimaeus to the feet of the king. And then we get into verse 51. And he says, so Jesus answered him and said to him, what do you want me to do? What do you want? Rabboni, that I may receive my sight. Months and months ago, I was reading this passage and I was thinking about that question. What do you want me to do for you? And I kicked that around and really meditated on that for a while. What do I want? If I was standing there face to face with God and he asked that question of me, what do you want me to do for you? What would you say? How would you respond to that question? And I thought, well, man, I'd love to say, Master, I want my kids to grow up and serve you and to just be fully devoted, fully sold out to you. I want them to be healthy and I want them to be happy and I want a house full of squishy grandbabies. I want them to live that life. Maybe some of you would say that. Some would say, right now, they'd say, Jesus, I need you to heal my body. It's broken. It's used up. Heal my body. Some would say, Master, my marriage is in tatters. I need you to stitch my marriage back together. Some would say, listen, I've gotten to this point in my life, whatever point that is, and my life has no meaning, it has no purpose. I just feel like I'm going through the motions every day. Give me meaning. Help me, Lord, to find a purpose, something that I can wake up in the morning and jump into and do it for you. All those are great questions or answers. All those are valid answers. And I kept turning that question over and over and over in my mind. And I would think about it. And what would I say? And then I really came back to what Bartimaeus said. Lord, I want to see. And maybe this blind man who had no ability to see the world as we understand sight could see something in this moment that we don't see. I want to see. And so I'm praying about that. And this is where I landed. I think that his answer was the right answer. Because, Lord, I want to see as you see. I want to see me the way you see me. I want to see the opportunity to minister the way you see that opportunity. I want to see how that this broken and sin-filled and ugly world is made right by the blood of Jesus Christ. I want to see that. So what are you saying, Pastor? I think that the answer is, I would say to him, I want to see what's going to happen in these next 3 days when you are on that cross, when you're beaten, when you die. And then, Lord, I want to see you when you're resurrected. Because you see here, church, when we are made right with God, when our life is made right with God, when we have fellowship with God that way, when we see as God sees us and we can talk to him and be made right and whole in him, suddenly everything in our life changes in that moment, and our entire life becomes something different. Because you see, when you've been renewed, when you've been revived, when you've been healed, when you've been made whole and different from the inside out, it fundamentally changes who you are, and you live differently. It changes how you parent when Christ is the center of your world. It changes how you act in your marriage, how you interact with your spouse, and suddenly you're not so focused on yourself, but you're focused on serving and loving your spouse the way that Christ served and loved the church. Bartimaeus said, "Rabboni, I want to see." Rabboni. That's a great Greek word there, and it means master. It means savior. But there's a little article in front of it that's even more important than the words master or savior. It's my master, my savior. You see, before this, if you think back to those couple verses before, he was saying, Son of David, Jesus of Nazareth, Son of David. That was how Jesus was known. Son of David. It was a messianic title that was given to Jesus. But in this up-close conversation, it changes. And the way he addresses Christ is very different. Now, I was studying, I was looking, there's only one other time in the gospel that anybody else ever uses that word, Rabboni. And that's Mary Magdalene at the empty tomb when she comes and she sees the risen Christ. And she says to him, Rabboni, my master, my savior, my Lord. You see, Bartimaeus is personal. It's my master, my savior, I want to see. Church, when we understand who we are in Christ, it becomes very personal. We change. It changes the way we live. It changes the way we operate. And you find a sense of value that comes from that relationship. My master, my savior. I love in this verses where when he gets up, he throws his garments behind. You see, when you come to Christ and you make that personal declaration, you've got to leave all the past parts of your life behind. The things that were your identity. You see, Bartimaeus was no longer a blind beggar. That wasn't who he was. He had an encounter with the Christ. Church history tells us that Bartimaeus actually went on and had a ministry within the church. That's why many believe that Mark uses his name here. It was his testimony. And he's saying, listen, you guys know Bartimaeus. Let me tell you his story. This is what happened when he heard that Christ was coming by. Now, church, we live in a different world today, a different time, and we don't have to wait for some chance moment that Jesus is walking down our street. The Holy Spirit is everywhere. The presence of God is everywhere. Wherever you are right here in this moment, driving in your car, sitting in your living room, the presence of God is right there with you. And you can holler out to him, "Rabboni, Rabboni, I want to see. I want to see." Jesus says to him, "Go, your faith has healed you." Immediately he receives his sight. If you were standing there, how would you have responded to that? If just a few moments earlier you were telling this guy, "Shut up!" And then you stand there and you witness his release from that prison of blindness, and he can see the master's face. He can see the sun. He can see the colors of the world all around him. How would you respond in that moment? I don't know, whoever's coming to the piano, if you come. I think getting to know Jesus as your personal Savior, that's what it's really like. It's receiving your sight. It's being able to see yourself as God sees you, not as some broken, flawed person, but as someone who is forgiven. As a child of the King, I want to see. Stand with me, if you will, please. Dear Heavenly Father, as we stand here this morning, Lord, I pray that you will touch our eyes, Lord, our spiritual eyes, or remove the blinders that are there, Lord, the things that the enemy says to us and tries to put in front of us to limit our ability to see you and to see who you are. Lord, give us the courage to pray that prayer. Lord, I want to see. Lord, I pray specifically for the person here today that when they look at themselves, all they see is their mistakes. Lord, I pray right now that you will open their eyes and let them see just how beautiful they are in you. Just how perfect they are in you. Lord, help us see ourselves cloaked in your righteousness, in your perfection. Help us to see ourselves as God sees us. And Lord, every time that the enemy tries to tell us we're something less, Lord, give us the boldness to remind him that he's a liar. And that I am made perfect through the blood of Jesus Christ. I am healed through the blood of Jesus Christ. I am forgiven through the blood of Jesus Christ. I am renewed through the blood of Jesus Christ. And I have a place and a purpose and a future because of the blood of Jesus Christ. With every head bowed and every eye closed, if you don't know the Lord as your Savior, it's been a long time. Today is that day. Today is that day. And I'm going to ask everyone that's here to pray this prayer with me. Repeat after me right now. Dear Lord, I want to see. I want to see my heart made new. I want to see myself as you see me. Forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. Make me new. Give me the courage to follow you. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. If that's the first time you've prayed that prayer or first time in a long time, I'll be at the back door after service. I'd love to talk to you for just a few minutes. And as you leave here today, know this: God says you are beautiful. You are absolutely beautiful. You are fearfully and wonderfully and perfectly made. Don't forget our Wednesday night Bible study and prayer at 6:30, Bible study at 7 next week. Don't forget Sunday school at 9:30, and then we have a quick meeting right after church. Council, don't forget we have just a real quick meeting right after church today. And we'll do that in my office real quickly. I'm going to ask Brother Todd DeShong if he will to dismiss us in prayer this morning. God bless.